I'm delighted to welcome Derek Davis of Babylon AD back to Dawn Osborne in session. Derek, how are you doing? Where are you in this world?
Right outside the Bay Area in California, and I'm doing great.
Okay. Now, you got this new album coming out. It's Rome Wasn't Built in a Day. Is that a reference to the fact that we've had to wait 7 years to hear from the band again?
Yeah, kind of, I guess, in a way. Also, it took us a while to write and record this album. You know, the whole COVID thing kind of screwed everything up and just pushed everything back. But we had some of these songs written a few years ago, and we just kept nailing it down till we had the best songs that we thought were going to go on the album. And it took a while.
I mean, it's worth the wait. I absolutely love the album.
Oh,
so
great.
I'll put that down. I mean, I have to mention, sometimes love is hell. I mean, it takes me back to that sweet spot when everything was right with the world musically. That's what I said on Facebook about it, and I really believe it.
All right, cool. Yeah, I think that's going to be our third single.
Okay. And I think your voice sounds better than ever as well. So you clearly haven't like abused it and worn it out.
Sometimes I abuse it and wear it out. Then I think that kind of keeps it a little bit of character in it, you know?
Yeah, actually, I was going to ask you about that unique vibrato that you have in it. I mean, have you always had that? And did people say that to you from an early age? Because nobody else sounds like you. That's something else that I said. You know, I mean, I would know a song was being sung by you and it wouldn't be anybody else. I would know.
Yeah, I do get that a lot. And to be honest with you, I don't know really how I started that or when it started or you know, it's not like I thought of it and said, let me try this. It just kind of popped out like that, you know. When I was young, I tried to imitate guys like Steven Tyler and Sammy Hagar, you know. So maybe they've got a little bit of a vibrato. I don't know, you know, but when you're 14 years old and you're in your garage or your bedroom and you're trying to sound like those guys, you know, you try to cop. So maybe they had some of that, you know, I'm not really sure. I don't remember.
I mean, to me, it's like listening to an old friend, you know, because I used to, I mean, that Babylon AD first album, I totally wore it out. I don't know how many thousands of times I listened to it. And then there it is. It's that voice and it's back, you know, and, you know, it's kind of, it feels like, you know, warm and fuzzy type of thing. Do you know what I mean? It's just because, you know, it's back to my teenage years. I think everybody loves music from their teenage years.
Absolutely. I do too. Yeah, I know. Every time I hear, that's all I really listen to be honest with you, is stuff that I elementary school till about maybe 25. That's the kind of music I listen to. You know, I don't really listen to anything that's new or even in the last probably 20 years that's new. You know, I just listen to the stuff that just reminds me of a place or a time, you know?
Yeah. And there's a lot of emotion in the voice as well. I mean, I think there's a lot of raw emotion in the song Sometimes Love Is Hell. And also there's like a sort of a primal scream type thing in I Will Never Break Again. I mean, it
Oh,
seems
yeah.
like when you get older, you've got more to sing about kind of thing in terms of emotions because you've been through more shit.
Yeah, I concur with that 100%. That's exactly the way I see it too. And you have more to draw from your experiences in life, you know. And so I mean, I know I write way better lyrics than I used to write. You know, I know Bangle the Bells was our big hit or whatever, but I don't think I'd ever write that song now. You know, I would probably think the title's too corny. I'd say, oh, that, you know what I mean? I just have more stuff to say now. You know, I'm growing up now. So.
And one last thing about Sometimes Love Is Hell. You got those telephone cameos in, you know, like that old Hurricane song. Do you know what I'm talking about?
I've never heard a Hurricane song in my life, I don't think. So
All
I could.
right. Okay. And again, that's from the same era. You know, so that stuff about, you know, you being on the telephone, it takes me back because of the Hurricane kind of songs that did that as well, or at least their most famous song that did that.
That part reminds me, and a few people that I've talked to, reminds me of the ELO song, Telephone Line. That's kind of not the idea from, you know.
All right. Okay. Well, ELO's
That
kind
far
of on
back.
my radar a bit, you know.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like elementary school, ELO, you know, was my band for about a year, you know.
Okay. And Wrecking Machine was the first single. And it's got a video about AI. So do you want to take a say a little bit about why it's about AI and you decided to do that?
Well, so I wrote the song about a girl that was having mental problems, but at the same time, you know, as I was writing the lyrics, all I'd see on the news every day was AI stuff. You know, it just seemed like everybody's talking about AI, how it's going to transform the world and all this stuff. So then I started thinking, well, what about a girl that's really a robot, AI robot, you know, sexy hot AI robot in the future, and she just takes over the world and destroys it, world domination, you know? That kind of thing. So I had the idea and I wrote the lyrics down, and after I wrote the idea for that, I did a video treatment, and then I showed it to the guys. I said, "What do you think?" And they were like, "Wow, this is great. Okay." So I got all the parts together that I needed, and we shot the video. We actually shot the video only 3 weeks ago,
Okay.
and yeah, I spent a week editing it, and bam, it's out now.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, the world has turned really, and it's enabled you to bring this kind of record out again and for, you know, people to be receptive to it. I mean, you know, loads of cowbell, you know, and classic rock is back, hallelujah. And because it's
Yeah,
very
the
much, there's
same.
no point making music that isn't going to be, I mean, not that I ever, I mean, I went out looking like Doro at the time, you know, at the height of Nirvana. I didn't give a shit. But in generally, it's just not worth making music that people won't receive well, I guess.
Yeah, I think there is a slight comeback with the hard rock stuff. Because I think people are, like you said before, you're reliving your past, your funnest time in life, all the stuff that you had, and now you're older now. People are older, they've had kids, you know, or their kids are in college or something. You're like, and you just gravitate to where the best part of your you know, the parties and all the fun you used to have and everything like that. And the music always stays with you, you know. And I'm sure probably it's that way for your parents that listen to Frank Sinatra or Dean Martin or something. You know, they probably hear that stuff and get a kick out of that, like we do our stuff. You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, my dad was Rolling Stones, Bob Dylan, that kind of
Yeah.
stuff. So, yeah.
I still listen to Bob Dylan all the time and Rolling Stones all the time. I think that's where the best lyrics are at.
Okay. And I was going to ask about songwriting, actually. Are you doing all the songwriting? I mean, Rome wasn't built in a day. That's got a really catchy chorus, you know, so it's kind of like sophisticated sort of thinking behind the songs.
I write all the lyrics and all the melodies, and I do all the arrangement and production. The guys give me clips, like riffs and things like that, you know, guitar riffs, maybe with a drum behind it or whatever, and then I'll take it, I'll make it into a song. And then I write 100% of the songs. So it's about 50-50. You know, I don't care where the song comes from. I'm not one of those guys where it's like, you know, there's got to be my songs, whatever, because I've got another 20 songs that, you know, we could have put on there that are my songs, but I'm not like that. I'm like, let me find the best songs. I don't care where they come from. I don't care if it's even an outside writer, you know, as long as it's the best representation of Babylon AD. So on this song, I think there's seven songs that was co that I co-wrote and four songs that I wrote, but it really doesn't matter to me, you know.
Okay. And I was going to mention the guitar because there's some brilliant 80s kind of like guitar solos on Looking for a Heartbeat and Shut Up. Two I particularly picked out the guitar on.
Yeah, that's Ron Fresky. He's a really great guitar player, and he's the mastermind behind the riff of Bangle the Bells. So usually people know when Ron's playing because he's got a real wicked like vibrato, like yeah. He could stretch that vibrato out for days sometimes. A lot of cats can't do that, you know. And I know a lot of good guitar players. When I talk to them, they think, you know, they'll go, "Man, that Ron, I don't know how he does that with his vibrato." And they're great guitar players. I'm like, "Well, really? That is it that cool?" Yeah, you know. So yeah, Ron has his own distinct sound, and then John Matthews has his own distinct sound too. And when I mixed this album, I made sure that Ron was on the left-hand side of the speaker system, and John was on the right-hand side. So if anybody wanted to know who they were listening to, you know, and they play completely different anyways, that's the way it is. John's on the right, Ron's on the left, you know?
Okay, okay. And I wanted to ask about the last track, Super Beast, because that's an instrumental. Give us, tell us about that, because it's kind of, you know, obviously a bit on its own at the end.
Mm-hmm. That was just something that Ron felt like doing. We were basically done with the album. He said, hey, man, I have this really cool riff and everything. And I listened to it, and I didn't really see how any kind of lyrics should go with it. I said, this is just a really cool riff to me. He goes, let's just put it on there, man, as a jam. And everybody just kind of added their parts. It was real fast. The drummer and the bass player didn't even know the song, you know, and John and Ron had worked out the guitar parts pretty much. And then they just jammed it, and we did a quick demo, and then we went in the recording studio and we just said, just jam, you know, just play whatever you want. So there's a lot of riffing on that song. You know, that's our Frankenstein.
Oh, yeah. Okay. 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 All right. And you got two original members from the original lineup, have you? And who's going to be touring the record? Because you're going to be touring the record. Who's in the band?
Yeah, we've already got a lot of different shows lined up. You know, we're playing the Whiskey and Monsters on the Mountain in Tennessee, and we're getting offers just about daily now to play across the states and everything. So we're putting all that together. You know, we don't want, to be honest with you, I don't want to, and I know most of the guys don't want to. We don't want to go out there like we used to do, like 3 months at a time, you know, wear ourselves out. We'd rather go weekend warrior style, or we've got a couple of places where we're going to play 2 weeks at a time, that kind of thing. You know what I mean? And good dates, special dates, you know, not just throw it out there. We're going to do some stuff in Europe. And like I said, we got a lot of stuff coming up. So people will be able to see us. You know, if they go to our website, BabylonADBand.com, they'll see where we're playing and things like that, you know.
Okay. So you're going to make it to the UK?
Yeah, we're going to play over there. I think right now we have 3 dates booked, I think it is, and they're trying to add a fourth one. It's not till early next year, though.
Okay.
I can't get the exact details because it just popped up about a week ago, and my manager and the booking agents are all getting everything set up right now, you know.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Fantastic. The last time I saw you on Mork, Monsters of Rock Cruise, and I saw you at the Welly in Hull. It was in Hull.
Oh, yeah. Hull, yeah.
And I just thought I'd mention, because it's funny, you know, the next day I heard that you got in trouble for partying after the show. And I don't know who with, and I don't know what you did, but you got in trouble. And I thought to myself, well, what's an 80s like rock band supposed to do? Are they supposed to come along and drink tea, you know?
What was the story? Because we got hundreds of those kind of stories. Refresh my memory. What did we get in trouble for?
Well, they didn't say, but it's something to do with girls. I don't know. I have no idea. But I thought to myself, well, what do you expect from an 80s rock band, you know?
We've always been known for a pretty party, a lot of partying. And after the shows, it's kind of like the highlight, really, for us. You know, a lot of guys, you know, at our age, you know, they go back to the hotel and go to sleep. But, you know, we've always, you know, I don't know. We just grew up like that. We grew up outside of Oakland. So we've always kind of did a lot of partying and just had a lot of fun, you know.
Oh, when I was about 17, it was about 1987, something like that. I went to stay in San Francisco, and we went to the Omni in Oakland, and we saw all sorts of bands like Kix and not Megadeth, Metallica. We saw Metallica before they were huge, you know. That venue wasn't that big. It was quite big. And I almost like got knifed in a knife fight. I mean, and we could hear the gunshots as we were going in one night. And I just like pushed everybody in because I wasn't used to that. Everyone else go, oh, yeah, there's a gunfight. And I'm like, no, get in.
Yeah, we shot our video Bad Blood there on our second album. We shot our video Bad Blood, and that was the day of the Rodney King riots. And outside the club, while we were playing inside, guys were fighting. Two guys got killed right outside the club while we were shooting the video. You know, I mean, I'm talking like right outside the front door. you know, but we didn't stop. We just kept shooting and was like, you know, we had security and everybody was telling us what was going on, but the place was packed because it was like a live gig, you know, and they just kept rolling the cameras over and over again and things like that, you know. But yeah, Oakland is pretty crazy, you know.
I don't think that place is even there now, is it?
Oh, it's not there anymore. John Nady used to own it.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's another fun memory because I did get home with I didn't actually get shot. So
you got a good story out of it.
So what's next for you?
What's next for us? we're doing. We just shot the video for "Rome Wasn't Built in a Day." That's going to be our second single, and that's in editing process right now. And we just went to radio with the Wrecking Machine. You know, the video's out right now, and that got released 2-3 days ago. Well, Tuesday, I guess, went to radio and video, and we're hoping that it'll take off at radio. We've got a great response so far. I've got a lot of interviews like what I'm doing with you right now, scheduled pretty much every single day of the week. So the band's pretty, you know, we're energized, and everybody's pretty excited. You know, it's like a good shot in the arm. We've got a great album, you know, great record company. We've got the radio team. We've got management. We've got things that we haven't had in a long time that are pushing things along. So it's just not the band, you know, weeding our way through things. We have a lot of good personnel working for us now.
Okay, well, that's fabulous. I mean, I really do love the album, and I'll be looking forward to seeing you live next year early when you come to the UK.
Sounds good. I look forward to meeting you.
Thank you so much.
All right.